Hi, everybody.
Hi, and welcome to the first episode of So That's How It Works.
Language is a very important part of our lives. We use it to communicate and interact with people. It helps us to express our thoughts and feelings.
Yes, language is made up of words, phrases, and sentences. We use these words, phrases, and sentences to carry out a number of functions. We can greet people, explain things to people, inquire about things, clarify questions, express joy or sadness, and so on.
The form of a sentence is its shape or appearance. A sentence can take the form of a statement, I am a Martian, a question, do you like me? An imperative, sit down.
Okay.
No, not you, Jason. Or even an exclamation, wow, what a handsome boy. Not you, Jason. These sentences convey different meanings. Therefore, we have to use language thoughtfully in a situation. This will help us say what we want to say clearly and correctly.
Let's meet Mingwei, Farhan and Ramu. They're out fishing by a river on a bright sunny morning.
Listen carefully to what they say and mean. They are carrying out different language functions.
Pay attention to the form, that is, the type of sentence that they are using to perform those functions. Pay attention also to the words that they use to make up those sentences.
Mingwei, hi Farhan, good morning. Oops, I'm sorry.
Hi, good morning.
What on earth are you doing?
Well, I'm applying sunblock.
Not now, Farhan.
Sunblock? What is it for?
My fishing.
Farhan, that's not polite, Farhan. You shouldn't interrupt people when they're talking.
Well, it's a cream or oil that you rub into your skin in order to stop the sun's light from burning you.
My fishing rod's in the river!
That's not the way to fish, Farhan. Most hold the rod and only drop the line into the water. Not the whole rod!
It fell in!
Why, see, you should have told us earlier.
Ah!
I think he's crazy.
You're right.
Ah!
Shouldn't we help him look for his fishing rod?
Yes. I think we should. Come on, let's go.
So, what did Ramu, Mingwei and Farhan say and do? What language functions did they perform?
And what language form did they use to carry out those functions?
Remember what Ramu said when he first saw the boys? He said,
Hi Mingwei, hi Farhan, good morning.
Well, Ramu was greeting Mingwei and Farhan. His function was to greet, and he did it by using the words hi and good morning.
Let's take a look at the language function to apologize. Do you remember who apologized and why he apologized? You do? You don't? Well, it was Ramu. When Ramu said, I'm sorry, he was apologizing for scaring the fish away. He used the word I'm sorry to carry out the function. Well, Ramu could have also used another language form to achieve the same function. He could have used the words, please forgive me.
Let's take a look at another part of that fishing scene again. Try and spot the language functions that were carried out and the forms that were used.
What on earth are you doing?
Well, I'm applying sunblock.
Did you identify the language functions? If you did, good for you. But if you did not, let me help you out. When Mingwei used the words, "What on earth are you doing?" he was inquiring. Inquiring is a language function. The language form that he chose was a question. And when Ramu answered Mingwei's question and told him what he was doing, Ramu was explaining to Mingwei. The function of Ramu's statement was to explain, and he used a statement to explain.
Okay, so far we have come across these language functions: to greet, to apologize, to inquire, and to explain. Now, let's take a look at two other language functions from the Fisher Boys video before we move on to the next segment. Well, while Farhan was going berserk in the river, Mingwei said something and Ramu replied.
I think he's crazy.
All right.
So Jason, what was Mingwei trying to do when he said, "I think he's crazy"?
Well, he was expressing what he thought of Farhan at that time. He was giving an opinion, and what he said was in the form of a statement. And Yasmin, what language function was Ramu trying to get across?
Well, Ramu was agreeing with what Mingwei said. He used the words, "You are right," which is a statement, to agree with Mingwei's opinion.
Okay, don't go away. We'll be right back with the next segment.
When we read novels, stories, poems and play, we begin to go on an exciting journey. We begin to see the world through other people's eyes. Isn't that so, Jason?
Yeah, that's right, Yasmin. It's a journey in which we meet many different characters and come across many types of events. And the language, the writers use it so creatively to express their ideas, thoughts, feelings, values and beliefs. So, why don't you tell them about The Dead Crow, Yasmin?
Oh, okay, Jason. Well, the poem's about the environment. It was written by Dato' A. Samad Said, who happens to be one of Malaysia's most popular writers.
And the theme of the poem is pollution and its effects on people and other living creatures.
Enough said, let's follow our friends Ayman, Ganesh and Andy on their little journey with the dead crow.
Have you watched Finding Nemo?
Oh yes.
I just love Nemo. Cute thing.
Aha, a bird!
Where? It's just a crow.
And a lucky one too.
What do you mean a lucky crow?
Well, it can live happily here, away from the city. Do you still remember the poem we learned in school, The Dead Crow by A. Samad Said?
Oh yes, I remember. Someone found a dead crow in a drain, killed by the air pollution in the city.
Yeah, smoke from factories, fumes from lorries, buses, cars, motorcycles, dust, cigarette smoke.
Exactly my point. The quality of air is so bad. It isn't good for people and animals. But out here, it's so fresh and clean.
Hey, do you guys remember the haze that we suffered from some time ago?
Yeah, it was because of the forest fires in Indonesia. My little sister had to wear a mask because she couldn't breathe the polluted air. How did the fire start?
Sometimes forest fires start because of the hot weather. But sometimes people burn the forest to clear the land before they start farming.
Gosh! That destroys forest areas!
And kills the animals too.
Do you know what I think? I think A. Samad Said is trying to express his disappointment at what the people are doing to the environment. I think he's really sad that people don't care about what they're doing.
The Dead Crow. He saw a dead crow in a drain near the post office. He saw an old man gasping for air and a baby barely able to breathe in a crowded morning clinic. This land is so rich. Why should we suffer like this? I want clean air for my grandchildren. I want the damn fools to leave the forest alone. I want the trees to grow, the rivers run free, and the earth covered with grass. Let the politicians plan how we may live with dignity, now and always.
Andy!
I'm sorry, I was just thinking of the poem.
Do you know why we learn good poems, like The Dead Crow in school?
Well, firstly, it helps us in our aesthetic acquisition of imaginative and creative writing. Secondly, it develops fluency, proficiency, and accuracy in our spoken and written protocol.
Thirdly, it makes us aware of current issues like the conservation of the environment.
Okay. Don't use many big words, Andy. You're confusing us. And scaring the crow away.
That was a very big crow.
I don't think I want to meet that crow.
Neither do I.
Well, we have just seen Aiman, Ganesh and Andy talking a little about the poem. We have also just seen Dato' A. Samad Said, the poet himself, in action reading his poem. Now that's a rare experience, isn't it, Yasmin?
Yes, it certainly is. Well, Jason, I was just wondering about the poet's tone. I don't think he was angry. To me, I think he was pleading. You know, he didn't really sound angry to me.
Yeah, I got the same feeling too. You know what I think, Yasmin? I think the author really loves the environment and does not want to see it destroyed.
I couldn't agree with you more. I believe that the author have given us a very clear message. Don't destroy nature.
And there's a message for the government too. Carry out activities that preserve life, not destroy it. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to our third segment, which is simply called Oops. Oops is about the common mistakes we make in the English language. We sometimes make mistakes when we speak or write.
That's right, Yasmin. Sometimes mistakes in language occur because we do not fully understand how the English language works. We make mistakes in spelling, in grammar, and in saying what we mean.
Let's watch this scene which involves Farhan and Mingwei. Jason, who makes a mistake in this conversation?
Farhan, so watch out for all the boo-boos that he makes.
Wow, what a beautiful bird. With beautiful blue feathers.
Really? Where? Are its feathers more blue than my shirt?
I wonder what it's called.
Hey. Mingwei, I'm an expert on birds. I just take one look at the bird's eyes, and I'll be able to name it. You know, it's this special talent that some people have. Can you borrow me your binoculars?
Sure. Here you go.
It's a pigeon. No. A hornbill. No, wait a minute. An eagle. No, it can't be an eagle.
An owl. Yes. Definitely an owl. With his big, ugly, evil eyes.
Oh.
seems like he made 2 slip-ups, Yasmin.
2? Uh-huh, he did. Can I explain the first one?
Be my guest.
Okay, watch this.
Hey. Mingwei, I'm an expert on birds.
Farhan used incorrectly. He should have used an. The reason is that the word that comes after is expert and it starts with the vowel sounds E. The rule is this. If a word starts with the vowel sound A-E-I-O-U, we should put an before it. Here's what Farhan should have said.
I'm an expert on birds.
Let's take a look at the next mistake that Farhan made.
Can you borrow me your binoculars?
Here's Farhan's problem. It has to do with his choice of words. He used me after the word borrow. He should have used the word lend instead. Here's how.
Can you lend me your binoculars?
Farhan could have used the word borrow if he had said it this way. Mingwei, can I borrow your binoculars? So remember, next time if you want to use the word borrow, use I before it, okay?
Jason, I have a question. Farhan asked Mingwei whether his blue t-shirt was more blue than the bird's feathers. That sounds kind of odd, doesn't it?
Let's look at the replay first.
Are its feathers more blue than my shirt?
The colour blue is an adjective. When we use adjectives to make comparisons, we either add ER at the end of the word or put the word more in front of it. The problem here is that the colour blue is not a word that can be compared. In informal English, people do use more blue or bluer. It's not wrong, but it's not usually used either.
What if I was desperate and I needed to tell a friend that my blue whatever is more bluer than her blue whatever?
Don't panic, Yasmin. You just say that your blue whatever is a lighter blue or a darker blue than her blue whatever.
Oh, all right.
Well, don't go away. We'll be right back with the last segment of So That's How It Works. Do you know what we're going to do now? We're going to listen to a song called Put Your Hands Together.
So, listen to the song, put your hands together and sing along.
Keep the rhythm off the beat. Yasmin's gonna take you through the song, so don't leave your seat.
Let's take a look at the lyrics of the song. We have words that are imperatives, and much of the song was in the simple present tense. We use imperatives to make requests or give commands. Listen to this song is an example of an imperative sentence. Listen is an imperative. It orders or tells us to listen. Here are 3 more examples of sentences with imperatives from the song. Put your hands together, clap your hands, and stamp your feet. Phew, that was a mouthful. I think I'll let Jason tell you about the simple present tense. Jason, Oh, Jason, I think I'll have to use an imperative to get his attention. Jason, tell them about the simple present tense.
Gosh, an imperative. Okay. Okay, let's see. We use the simple present tense to talk about habitual, permanent, or repeated actions. We also use the simple present tense to talk about general statements, which sometimes we call universal truth. Here's an example from the song. The sun rises in the east. The sentence is a universal truth, something that is permanent, something that cannot be changed, and the verb rises is in the simple present tense. Let's take a look at these other examples of the simple present tense from the song. It sets in the west. Trees grow tall. Raindrops fall.
There is one more very important thing that we have to remember when we use the simple present tense. It's the
subject-verb agreement. A singular subject takes a singular verb, and a plural subject takes a plural verb.
Let's take a look at that example again. The sun rises in the east. The sun is a singular, just one. So, the verb that follows it should be a singular. That's why it's rises and not rise.
Are you ready to listen to the song again? But this time, you have to promise to sing along, okay?
And watch out for the imperatives and the simple present tense. Here goes!
We hope you had fun learning with us, and don't forget to watch the next series.
Thanks for spending time with us. Take care and see you again on... So that's how it works.